case you're watching on the internet and you didn't know what was going on, just looking at Larry's head, this is our prayer time. So I know it all doesn't pick up on audio, but we do this. We've been committed to doing this for, like Larry said, for a while now. And we want to be praying and praying for our president in a re-election. I think that's something we got to jot down and continue to jot down and keep praying for the things that God's doing in our lives and through our lives. It's, believe it or not, it's 4th of July coming, and almost feels like it's cold in here tonight again. We're keeping the doors open. You know, that's part of the virus thing that we got to do to keep fresh air in here. And so, you know, if it gets chilly at night, bring a sweater, you know, because we're going to keep doing this for a period of time, keep everybody safe the best we can. As far as the virus going on, they're shutting things down again. Lord willing, they're not going to shut us down. But if it does something, you hear something, you all got my phone number. You could text me, call me, or else we'll put something up on the web. But we're planning on being here Sunday. You know, I mean, it's a 4th of July weekend. I know a lot of people used to all travel, but I telling somebody tonight, well, I'm going to travel to my backyard for 4th of July. That's about as far as we're to go. So looking forward to a day off together with my wife and kids. So. Well, if you have your Bible, well, here we are in Colossians chapter 4. It just seemed like yesterday we started it, this marvelous study through the book of Colossians. Last week we dealt with the interpersonal relationship and how it all flows through putting on a new man. And as we were emphasizing, it really doesn't work to follow Paul's advice in Ephesians or Colossians if you're still trying to do that underneath the energy of the flesh. We need the power of the Spirit. We need to be walking as Christ would have us to walk. And so he ended up chapter 3 with the responsibilities of an employee, but now he goes with the employer. He says, "Masters, give your servants that which is just and equal, knowing that you also have a master in heaven." And you say, "Master, give your servants really equal pay," or I mean just pay. Pay them for what they're worth, a day's wage. Give them an honest wage back. And I love it where he tells us, knowing that you have a master in heaven. And that's always a very important something for us to remember. God's ruling over all affairs. No matter who you are, where you're at, there's this authority that we used to say in work, the buck stops with me. You know, I'm the answer man. All the problems are all going to fall upon me. But in reality, it falls upon our Lord. He's the one that's ruling over us. And if we are in a place of as an employer, we should be looking for God for wisdom, for direction, and the things that we are doing concerning our employees. As he says, remember that you also have a master in heaven, and you want to be treated right. You want to be treated, you know, fairly. But then in verse 2, he says, "Continue in prayer and watch in the same with thanksgiving." Notice what he's saying there. He's encouraging him to continue in prayer. Prayer is a very interesting thing, because we can get so busy and distracted about many things. But we can read books about prayers, you know, which I think there's great. And I encourage you sometimes to take a journey through the Bible and just study the prayers of the Bible, because we can glean so much from them. But, there's a time to talk about prayer. There's actually a time to pray. As we pray tonight corporately, but we need to be praying as individuals and the things that we could do, and we could affect the world. It's not so much I'm to be changing God's mind on a situation. Rather, I'm interceding, being obedient to God to help to see the world changed around us. I don't know about you. I heard mentioned here tonight a very, very good friend who was part of Agape Chapel for several years. His name was Rodney. Most of us remember him. And we were praying and praying and praying and figuring, okay, God, you're going to heal him. It's going to be good. And all the way up to the end, well, God had something better for him. the move to heaven. You know, and we all realize that, but during that time, God wants us to continue to pray and to seek for the healing and not to give up. But really, ultimately, we're saying, thy will be done. It's so important that we pray as we're praying here tonight for our nation and the work that God might want to do. I was contacted by our very good friend, Mike McIntosh, here the last few weeks. As he was looking, he was troubled by what was happening in the Midwest with the churches. You know, Mike has a dear heart for pastors and the churches and how they're feeling lonely. They're feeling, you get out there miles away from Calvary Chapel, Costa Mesa, Pastor Chuck, you start feeling, you could get feeling lonely out there. And with the COVID-19 and getting things started back up, it was really hurting. And so he says, Terry, could you send me some Chuck's books? And, you know, and so Agape Chapel, that's what we do. We try to use this as our ministry. And so we, you know, piled up a ton of books and we sent them Wisdom for Today, Effective Prayer Life, The Final Act. And I don't know, there's 5-6 different titles. And I got them a whole, you know, whole bunch of truck full of books, took them over to him, and he shipped them all to the pastors in the Midwest just to read them, to get something fired up and encouraged in their hearts. And he says, you know, I think God wants to do something in the Midwest. And so he says, we plan on doing 2 outreaches there. But right now it tells me they moved from 2 up to 31 events, and it continues to grow in, I think, 5 different states. And so he asks, he says, Terry, would your church be interested? I'm looking for some anchor churches that would stand behind this outreach this summer in prayer. I have 5 of them. Would you be the 6th church to be the anchor church that stand around the revival? It's called, it's here someplace, 2020heartland.org is the website. And I said, Mike, I don't think that's a question you need to even ask. We're just going to do it. That we'll, all summer we'll be standing behind this outreach as we want to see thousands of people that come to know the Lord. He says, you know, thank you, Terry. Have Chuck evolved through his books is strengthening. Many pastors are weary, some deforced, he calls it. If we can show them how to pray, do evangelism, have real faith, America could have a revival once again. So let's take part in praying for this. As Paul says, continue in prayer. There's a great work to be done. We are a minority in this country. We're a minority in this world. I'm talking about born-again evangelical Christians, not churchgoers. There's a big difference between the two. And as we not only do this work here in our Jerusalem, right here in Costa Mesa, Orange County, and then Samaria, and then to the outermost parts of the world, as some of you go out ministers in different countries, we need to be praying, continue to pray one for another. You know, I think I was saying to somebody earlier, that's the engine that makes the train go down the tracks, is prayer. And then he tells us that in the same with thanksgiving. He says, don't give up. He says, he goes, and watch the same without with thanksgiving. Do you see how he says watch? It's something that Jesus said over and over again. Jesus said, watch and pray. Be alert. Remember in the garden when his disciples went to sleep, what did he say to them? Could you just at least watch and pray with me for a little bit? You know, stay alert and pray. During the day, you might find things that, you know, as you're traveling that you're praying about. I made a deliver down to San Clemente today of some of Pastor Chuck's books, and I had a glorious time because over the period of time, I've turned the radio off. I'm not listening so much to Hannity or Fox News or whatever's on the radio. I've been shutting that off. And I find out that I, as I'm traveling along, the trip goes real fast when you're praying. You know, as things would come to my mind and heart as I was praying and giving thanks. Paul writes, as we'll see as we begin in the book of Thessalonians, that giving thanks unto God for all things everything concerning you, that's the will of God. And a lot of times people would ask me, say, Pastor Terry, what is the will of God for my life? I said, well, let's start with one thing. The one thing is to give thanks. That is the will of God in Christ Jesus. In verse 3, with all praying also for us, he says, would you please pray for us that God would open unto us the door of utterance to speak the mystery of Christ, which I also am also in bonds. And so as he said, he says, would you please pray for us? I think the most glorious thing that I have support here at Agape Chapel is known that Agape Chapel prays for me. The body of Christ here, even more personal, my friends. You guys are my friends, and you pray for me, and we pray for each other. And then as we go out, as we want to bring into Agape Chapel, Mike McIntosh and the outreach that he's doing and others, we want to pray. Why? That the opening of the door of utterance would happen. So this is how it works. I'm just kind of doing a little program. It's called Answers for Today. You know, Pastor Chuck was, say, hey, Terry, why don't you do, we're talking the last couple years of his life, never really happened, and on Cave Wave that I would do a little program where I would get these emails from pastor's perspective, and I would sit there and answer them on a radio type of thing, probably 2:00 in the morning. I don't know what it would have been, but, and so I kicked it around, and so my friend Dennis, I was talking to over at his channel a little while, I don't know how many years ago now, but he says, Terry, why don't you do that on video? And I go, okay. And my friend made a logo for me, Answers for Today. Another person, Bill Wynn, sent it up to Idaho to do the music opening. I go, okay, now I got an opening. How am I going to do that? So we went into studios and we started trying. And people started praying. Agape Chapel started praying for me and for the outreach. And I'm just blown away at how many people that TV program reaches, some 600,000 people that it's now reaching. And like Larry said, they picked us up at 250 different radio stations across the country. How does that happen? Verse 3, Paul says, wherein would you please pray for us that the door of utterance, that we might speak the mystery of Christ, that would not speak about us, but speak about the Messiah, to speak about Jesus. That's what it's all about. Nothing else really matters because life is short, isn't it? We're here one day and could be gone tomorrow. And what we do for Jesus Christ is what matters so much. And the mystery of Christ, of course, why Paul was put in bonds and, we've been going through it in Acts. And as you go through the story of Acts, what were they all upset about? That Paul would actually say that a Gentile could know Christ. And so that's why he was arrested, because he was dared bring the gospel to the Gentiles. And those what known as the Judaizers could not accept this, that God, for God so loved the world, that the gospel would go to everybody. So they brought him, and they arrested him, and they brought Paul to Caesarea, and they had three different trials, and that didn't work well enough. So they brought him in bonds all the way up now to Rome, where we'll be seeing on Sunday morning as we see the story unfold. So Paul now is writing this letter of Colossians from that jail. He says, that's what I'm in bonds for. Verse 4, that I might make manifest as I speak. He says, this is what I'm praying, that I might speak correctly, that I might share empower the word of God, that I might share what things that need to be speaking. And then he tells us, walk in wisdom towards them that are without, redeeming the time. Walk in wisdom to those who are without, those who don't know Jesus Christ. Let your life to be that positive witness of Jesus Christ. I think it's so important that we walk with wisdom to those, because God wants to use us, and we'll mention this here in a minute, to share the gospel with other people, that we're praying as we meet people and we're looking for opportunities to communicate the gospel of Jesus Christ. Do you see how he tells us that we should be redeeming the time? How quick time goes by. Today I was out back, and you know, I just look at it and go, you know, this minute just went by. I'll never have that minute again. And Paul realized that the life is going by so fast for him. And there was so much that he wanted to do. And I'm sure he was at a lot of times in pain and struggling. And he's really what he said, I don't want to waste any more time. I don't want to waste time. I want to redeem the time for the gospel of Jesus Christ, buying up every opportunity of to be able to share the hope of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I got a call a couple days ago for my friend John, and he was down at Lido, Iowa. He goes down there, and he says, he did this a few weeks ago. He says, every time I go down there, God brings for me people to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with. He says, Terry, that's all I want to do is redeem the time. I want to be used of the Lord. For me to be used of the Lord, I have to make myself available. Notice as he goes on in verse 6, let your speech be always with grace. Did you see that? With grace. Season with salt, that you may know what you ought to answer every man. He's saying that the grace of God is going to be the key that people need. What does the world need now? They're looking for answers. They need to know about a God that loves them. They need to know about the grace of God, because I don't believe people understand who God is. They believe that God's a God maybe they grew up around and heard about, but they've never experienced him personally. To know God personally is to know the God of grace and the God of love. And then as he tells us that, he says, seasoned with salt. And you know, that seasoned with salt, you know, adds a little flavor, adds a little spice, adds something to maybe, you know, be quick to be able to answer somebody, to tell them the truth of God's word. God uses your personality, you know that? The way he's developed you, each and every one of you are a little bit different. I'm so glad that we're all have a uniqueness of who we are. God will use your personality and bring it out so you can better communicate the gospel, so you can be doing the things that you should be doing. He says, as he tells us, to walk in wisdom, redeem the time, make your speech with grace. And now he tells us, you know, that our voice should be with seasoned with salt, that you may know how you ought to answer every man. That we should, Paul said earlier, that we should give every man an answer for the hope that lies within us. What's the hope? Is the power of the resurrection, that we'd be ready to share that. And now, as he kind of closes the book of Colossians, he mentions some friends of his. And of course, this first guy, all my state shall Tychicus declare unto you, who is my blood brethren and faithful minister and fellow servant in the Lord. There's something that, you know, I think Paul was a man that made friends well. And people would want to be around him in a sense that they were willing to travel with him. They were willing to give up their occupation for the gospel's sake. And he says that they're beloved brother, and notice what he says, faithful ministers and fellowship with in the Lord. So he treasured the fact that they were kinsmen, they were brethren. But he loved how faithful they were. Faithfulness to the ministry, whatever God calls you to do, I think is one of the key ways to be used of the Lord. That he's just not looking for us to, you know, to be necessarily the best in any profession or the greatest speaker, or the greatest talent per se. What he's looking for is faithfulness. And Paul recognized the faithfulness in his fellow, and he treasured fellowship. He says, fellow servant in the Lord. He says, you're a man of like-minded, like heart. You're just trying to reach people for the gospel of Jesus Christ. And he says, whom I have sent, verse 8, whom I am sent unto you for the same purpose, that you might know your state and comfort your hearts. Otherwise, this fellow was being brought the letter from Paul, as Paul was writing to the church there in Colossae from the prison in Rome. This is the guy that carried the letter to the church there. Isn't that something precious? Can you imagine if we ever would have actually had that original letter? Oh, my goodness. But we do, right before our eyes. A dear brother, one day we'll meet in heaven. Omniscius, verse 9, again, faithful and beloved brethren, who is one of you? Otherwise, he came from you there in Colossae. They shall make you known unto you all the things which are done here. Otherwise, Paul had freedom, even though he was in jail. He was still chained to a guard. He was underneath house arrest. And he was doing tremendous ministry there in Rome. So he says, this fellow's going to come, and he's going to share you all the good news what God is doing here in Rome. I think it's exciting as we get to hear missionaries come off the field, when Judy comes and share the things she's doing, or our friends as they come back and we get reports. And that's what he's saying, is this guy's going to tell you all the good news, how people's lives are being changed by the gospel. Articius, my fellow prisoners, salute you, and Marcus, sister son of Barnabas, touching whom you received commandment, if you come unto you, receive him. Of course, this is a story back at Acts chapter 19, verse 29. This is the Demetrius, the silversmith of that story. Remember that crazy silversmith and his brother Dimitri? You can learn more about him in Acts chapter 19. In verse 11, he says, "In justice, which is called Jesus, which is called justice, whom are of the circumcision, these only are my fellow workers under the kingdom of God, which have been a comfort unto me." Otherwise, his name Jesus was very common during that time. That's why you find Jesus is associated with Jesus of Nazareth. So we know who he's talking about. And so this guy, Justice, as you find there in the book of Corinthians and also in Acts, Justice lived right next to the synagogue there in Corinth. And Paul came, when he first came to visit Corinth, he met Justice, and he was a Jew, so he had a lot in common. And then when he came to Christ, he goes, oh my goodness, yeah, we could talk about Isaiah. We could talk about the scriptures. They had so much in common that he loved this so much. Epaphras, in verse 12, who is one of you, a servant of Christ, salute you, always laboring fervently for you in prayer, that you may stand perfect and complete in the will of God. What a man, what a ministry of intercessory prayer. You say, Lord, I want to be used of the Lord. And if you're moved for prayer, what a great verse to be able to put there for you to model your prayer ministry all about. That we would stand in a gap for each other. He says how he's laboring fervently for you in prayer. Fervently means he just didn't quit. They continued to intercede. They were battling for each other in prayer. You know, I have to admit, prayer's one area I feel like I'm such a novice. There's so many more areas I could grow in prayer. If I would just set aside time, slow down my life where I can intercede and I can learn from men like Epaphras what it meant to prayer, great prayers of women in the Bible, how they would spend that time in communing, in intercessory prayer is so important, because you know what you do when you intercede about for somebody? You know what you're not talking about? Is yourself. You're actually talking about somebody else's need. And so you're spending time laboring for their well-being. And he says in their prayers that they may stand perfect and complete in all the will of God. Folks, you could pray for that for me for any time you want. Say, what should I pray for Pastor Terry about? Let's turn it over to Colossians chapter 4, verse 12. Then, truly, that I might stand in all of the will of God and do the will of God. He mentioned this earlier back in Colossians chapter 1, verse 7. Very similar as he is praying. He was a man, certainly a prayer. In verse 13, for I bear him record that he had great zeal for you and them that are in Laodicea and them in Hierapolis. Luke, the beloved physician in Demas, greets you. And this is the real first time in this letter that we have mentioned Luke, his beloved physician. And Luke would have been a very, very handy guy to have around. Luke joined there. Basically, when Paul left Troas, Luke joined the ministry team of Luke. When you think of Paul, all that he went through, all the beatings, all the times he was left for dead, his body must have been a wreck. And God sent him Dr. Luke to be there. Not only that, God gave Luke, being a great physician and very detailed mind, to be able to write us the Gospel of Luke and also the book of Acts. I'm so thankful for this beloved physician named Luke. And you know, God brings people into your life to help you. You know, not all of them can be evangelists, not all could be pastors. All of you got different gifts and talents and everything else. And I thank God for there's some doctors that God brought into my life. I think of Dr. John Miller when I was very young in the ministry. You know, after we got done, with John, you know what he would do with have us do? He said, Terry, let's pray. I go, what, you mean in a doctor's office? That was the first time I ever been in a doctor's office, and every time I met with him, I prayed, and God, certainly in the last few years, with not only my truck accident and everything else, he brought by our wonderful friend and doctor here, Dr. Jim Hall, to be able to help me through all that, to get me walking back straight. I'm still working on it, but, you know, God brings people alongside to help. Aren't we thankful for the gifts and talents that we have? I'm sure Paul was saying, oh my goodness, Luke, the beloved physician, he was using his talents and gifting for the Lord. No matter what talents and gifts that you have, God will use that for his glory. You know, whatever it might be, I think it's so beautiful. Verse 15, salute the brethren which are in Laodicea and Nepres and this church which is in the house. Do you see that? The church, where's the church at? It's in the house. They hadn't built steeples yet. A mega church wasn't known. That didn't come to after Constantine, the big churches. Most churches were house churches, going from house to house. In fact, right now on a Thursday night at Agape Chapel, and those that are watching online, they would consider this a mega church. Home churches were sitting around their couches or laying on their, I don't know what they lay, depending where you're at, you know, and they would be ministering, talking about the Lord, praying and breaking bread and having that sweet communion you can get. And a lot of times you're involved with a bigger church, one of the things that happens is the breakdown of friendships and the breakdown of getting to know each other and caring for one another. And Paul is recognizing that this church, this house church, is from God. Another pastor, I won't mention his name, but he was saying that if you're not a church of at least 500 people, you should close the doors. When that came to me, and I said, well, maybe it's time for that fellow to retire. Because you look around across America, it's mid-America, like we were talking about earlier. If you call upon the name of Jesus, where two or three are gathered in my name, to me, that's, I'm having church. I'm enjoying fellowship with each other. I mean, you go to different parts of the world. It's not all like we have in big cities, the way churches gather now. Paul recognized this. In verse 16, and when this epistle is read among you, and this just thrills me. that they were taking this letter from Paul and they were reading it in these different churches, cause that it be read also the church of Laodicea, and likewise read it in the epistle of from Laodicea, and say to Arepaphus, or you try that a few times, take heed to the ministry which you received in the Lord that thou fulfilled it. And I think that's such sound advice. Take heed to the ministry which thou hast received from the Lord, the things that God has given you to do from him. He says that thou fulfill it. Don't fall short. Don't weary in well-doing. Ministry can be discouraging sometimes when things don't necessarily turn out the way you think they should be. But Paul is saying, don't give up. Hang in there, because God is doing a work that's beyond what you can see or know. Verse 18, this salutation by my hand of me, Paul, remember my bonds. Remember I'm in chains. Grace be with you. Amen. What a book. What a book I opened up with one of the greatest prayers that we have there in chapter 1. Talking about the preeminence of Christ as he took our journey through chapter 1. Then a strong, strong exhortation that we as believers, that we set our minds on things above, where Christ is sitting on the right-hand throne of God. And then as believers, knowing that we would live in the Spirit, that we would live as new men. You know, the thing is, where Jesus is sitting on the right-hand throne of God, sitting in that place of the high priest, ever making intercession for us. And I think every once in a while he says to the Father, say, Father, is it time for me to go get my bride? Is it time now? I think it's so quick. It's so, you know, right around the corner that Jesus Christ comes for his church. I don't know where heard it, and I don't know how true it is, but they say that Jesus doesn't sit all the times, but he actually stands. He says for the martyrs of those Christians who died for their faith as they received in heaven, he stands for them. That's a beautiful thought, to think how God honors our work, but I think he just embraces each and every one of us when our journey's done. And that he's longing for that day that we'll all be gathered together around his throne, which I believe is sooner than later. When we get into the book of Thessalonians, we're going to be talking about the end times once again. Paul's very detailed in dealing not only with the rapture, but also the second coming, as he deals with the Antichrist. Who is the Antichrist? What it's going to be about? And so I'm looking forward as the next few weeks, the next couple months, as we study the book of Thessalonians together. Why don't we go to the Lord in prayer? Father, thank you. Thank you so much on this beautiful night here in July that we are able to call upon you. Lord, as we read this letter that was handwritten by Paul, a letter that's filled with love, a letter that's filled with exhortation and encouragement, help us to take it to heart. And as we take this letter home with us, that we'll treasure it within our hearts, and that we'll seek to do the things. We seek to live out the things that we saw here tonight and we saw here the past few weeks. Lord, we believe that the day is so soon before you come for us. Lord, we want to come along and pray not only here for Costa Mesa, but across this country, that men and women would come to Christ. Lord, we ask for a special anointing upon Mike. Your Holy Spirit would fall upon him, his wife, the whole outreach team, as they get ready to leave in 2 weeks, I believe it is. I just pray for an open door. I pray for the city mayors, for the police officers of whatever city, community that he comes into, that they too might recognize the power of God in their midst. And Lord, that people might come to know Jesus Christ. Pray for the pastors who are discouraged. Lord, that they won't weary in well-doing, that you might gird them up and strengthen them. We just thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Why don't we all stand as John closes us in a song.